In this video, we'll learn structural holes. Last week, we introduced a classic theory of strength of weak ties. This week, we'll introduce a similar school of thought, but with different constructs of structural holes, brokerage, and closure. Those constructs were proposed by Robert Burt. First, what are structural holes? Structural holes are gaps or empty spaces between clusters in networks. Here, I point out two structural holes in the network you see on the screen. There are many structural holes in this network. The cluster on either side of the structural holes are aware of each other. They're just so preoccupied with their activities within their own clusters that they don't have the mental capacity to attend to the activities in another cluster. You can also consider those structural holes as buffers or insulators. Network closure refers to dense clusters of strong ties. Within a cluster, people tend to share similar information, ideas, and behavior. In network A, there are three clusters. Note 7 and 8 are in the same cluster. The ideas and views held by node 7 and 8 are more similar than those held by node 7 and 5. This is because node 7 and 5 are located in different clusters in network A. An individual who can fill the structural holes, that is, gaps or empty spaces, functions as a bridge between clusters. This individual has a structural advantage in the network. In network A, that individual is Abby. Abby fills the structural hole in the network and functions as a bridge between the clusters. Abby's structural position in network A allows her to play a brokerage role, which is an advantage over other nodes in the network because Abby can transfer or withhold valuable information from one cluster to another. Moreover, Abby can combine and integrate all information she receives from three different clusters and come up with the most innovative idea in network A. Abby is so important that she is the glue holding the network together. Once Abby leaves, the network falls apart. What are the downsides of the structure in network A? Network A is fragile. The network depends on Abby. This gives Abby disproportionate power over others in the network. In organizations, many administrators purposely build a structure of network A so that they can assume Abby's position in the network. They can take advantage of this network position to suppress dissenting views, to discourage node 7 to have a direct communication tie to node 5, and to withhold the evidence suggesting their unethical behavior or being incompetent at work. This is why most cult leaders build an organizational structure that looks like network A. Cult leaders control what you read. You cannot question their authority. To join the cult, you are required to cut ties with families and friends. If you see those signs, run as fast as you can. Now, let's look at a different network structure in network B. Network B has the same number of nodes in network A. It has 10 nodes. Bill has the same number of ties as Abby does. They both have three ties. Who is likely to have more innovative ideas, Abby or Bill? The answer is Abby. Even though Bill has the same number of ties as Abby does, Bill's ties are redundant. Why? because both contacts, that is node 1, 2, 3, are connected with one another. The idea Bill can get from node 1 is similar to the ideas offered by node 2 or 3. What's in common between the strength of weak ties and structural holes? They both acknowledge the importance of the absence of ties, particularly the ties your contacts are not connected to. According to the theory of strength of weak ties, the stronger the ties between two people are, the more likely their contacts will overlap. And weak ties are the bridging ties that function as the conduit of new ideas. Strong ties nurture strong trust, but if you want to innovate, you'd better focus more on building weak ties. You have weak ties first, and then those weak ties provide you with an advantageous position in the network. Your weak ties comes first, your bridging role comes second. The construct of structural holes, on the other hand, is the other way around. You have an advantageous position in the network first, and then you have better access to the resources in the networks, that is social capital. Your bridging role comes first, your social capital comes second. There are many measures of structural holes, including bridge counts, effective size, and constraints. Here we focus on a commonly used one, constraint. Constraint, as the name suggests, is a node-level metric that measures the extent to which a node is constrained in a single cluster. You can calculate the constraint measure in UCINet. If you have a low value of constraint in your social network, is it good or bad? In network A, Abby has the lowest value of constraint, 0.3333. It means Abby is the least constrained node in the network. Who are the most constrained nodes in network A? Node 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, and 9. They all have the same value of constraint, 1.1250. They are all constrained in a single cluster. They have no other information source. The constrained value of node 3, 5, and 7 is 0.6111, meaning they play a brokerage role between Abby and the cluster they belong to. Node 3, 5, and 7 fill structural holes in the network to some extent, but their brokerage role is not as strong as Abby. To build your social network, you should aim for a low value of constraint. How to do it? You position yourself as a bridge among different clusters. This requires you to not just calculate how many ties, that is, how many friends you have in your social network. If you are Abby and focus only on your ties with node 3, 5, and 7, you won't build a network with less constraints. To fill a structural hole, you must pay attention to how your friends are connected as well. In other words, you must have a good understanding of your friends' social networks. You need to know the social networks of node 3, 5, and 7. Now let's look at network B. Who has the highest constraint? Node 6. Node 6 is trapped between node 4 and 7. This is why node 6 has the highest value of constraint. Who has the second highest value of constraint? Bill. Bill's information source is also limited. Bill is constrained in the cluster that includes node 1, 2, and 3. Who plays the strongest brokerage role in the network? Node 4. Why? Node 4 has 4 ties and is connected to node 1, 2, 6, and 7. Each contact of node 4 is likely to bring in different information. If you analyze a network, it is very limited if you analyze only ego networks. This is because ego networks do not give you a big picture of how your friends are connected to one another. For example, the ego network for Abby and Bill are the same because they both have three direct ties. Without looking at how Abby's and Bill's friends are connected, you would not be able to draw a conclusion that Abby's network position is more advantageous than Bill's network position. So if possible, you should analyze a whole network instead of an ego network. Now let's review what we've learned over the last 2 weeks. To analyze a network, the first step many people take is to calculate centrality. If it is a direct network, we first find out who has the highest in-degree centrality and out-degree centrality. In-degree centrality means how many incoming ties a node has. The node I point out in the network has the highest in-degree centrality, meaning that node has the most incoming ties. Out-degree centrality means how many outgoing ties a node has. The node I point out in the network has the highest out-degree centrality, meaning that node has the most outgoing ties. Here, the calculation of both in-degree and out-degree centrality only takes into consideration of a node's direct contacts. The value of degree centrality is limited compared to betweenness and closeness centrality. The node has the highest betweenness centrality might not be the node with the highest degree centrality, but this does not mean the high betweenness centrality node is not important. The node is important, it's just in a different way. The node I point out in the network has the highest betweenness centrality. That node functions as a bridge between two clusters. The node has the highest betweenness centrality might not be the node with the highest degree centrality, but this does not mean the high betweenness centrality node is not important. The node is important, it's just in a different way. The node I point out in the network has the highest betweenness centrality. That node functions as a bridge between two clusters. Like betweenness centrality, closeness centrality is another centrality measure that looks beyond your direct contacts and take into consideration how your contacts are connected. Closeness centrality is the sum of geodesic distances of a node to all others. Geodesic distance means the shortest path length, so closeness centrality is the sum of the shortest path of a node to all the rest of the nodes in the network. Since geodesic distance is the shortest path, a node with the lowest closeness centrality means the node has the shortest path to the rest of the nodes. The node I point out has the lowest in-closeness centrality. It means in this direct network, that node's incoming ties allows the node to have the shortest path to the rest of the nodes in the network. It also means that node has the highest efficiency of incoming information. What about the node with the lowest out-closeness centrality in the direct network? Again, closeness means the sum of the shortest path of a node to all the rest of the nodes in the network. In the direct network, a node with the lowest out-closeness centrality means that node has the highest efficiency of outgoing information. We just identified important nodes, those central nodes in the network using different centrality measures. Next, let's identify structural holes in the network. The size of this network is small. It has only 61 nodes, so you may be able to identify structural holes visually. But when you have hundreds or even thousands of nodes, you will need some quantified measures. One of those measures, as we introduced earlier in this video, is called constraint. Constraint measures the extent to which a node is constrained in a single cluster. You can calculate the constraint measure in UCINet. The highlighted node has the lowest constraint, meaning that node fills a structural hole in the network. In other words, that node plays a brokerage role between two clusters. How to identify network closure? Let's refresh our memory. What is network closure? It refers to dense clusters of strong ties. Within a cluster, people tend to share similar information, ideas, and behavior. There are many ways to identify network closure. You can run all sorts of clustering algorithms. You've already practiced in Gephi. In UCINet, there are many ways to identify network closure as well. One way is to identify clicks. What is a click in network analysis? It means every node is connected to every other node. The upside of a click is that people in a click have high trust. The click is your safe space and comfort zone. The downside is groupthink. People in the click are less receptive to new ideas. The click can function as an echo chamber, trapping you in your comfort zone. Since people in the click tend to think in the same way, they reinforce each other's views. Over time, you may become more and more extreme. The constructs of structural holes, brokerage, and closure offer an understanding of social capital from a network perspective. As we've discussed repeatedly in this course, the whole is different from the sum of its parts. Similarly, social capital, that is, the resources embedded in the network, is different from the sum of human capital at an individual level. How much social capital you have in your social network does not necessarily depend on how many ties you have. You can build your social capital if you understand where you are located in your social network. You can position yourself within a closely connected cluster, so you are in the network closure. In this case, you build bonding social capital. You can also position yourself between two clusters, so you play a brokerage role. In this case, you build bridging social capital. And you can use many metrics from social network analysis to quantify bonding and bridging social capital. In this video, we learned structural holes, brokerage, and closure. Next week, we'll learn how to analyze two-mode networks.